All right, welcome everybody. This is the ORI FPGA meetup for the 3rd of December 2024. And we are here to talk about what we've done over the past week, what we have planned for the next week. If we have any roadblocks, anything blocking us, and if we need any resources from ORI. And it's a round table of reports of progress and sharing. And we'll have Aaron to start us off today.
Hello. Sure. So since last we spoke, I switched back from Opulent Voice, and this is with OpenCPI. I made sure that the applications I previously created were still functioning. I did try updating the Pluto SDR firmware to the latest version, but I might have caught it when it wasn't working the other day. So I need to try that again to make sure that I'm running the latest and my stuff still works for the latest. So at the previous meeting, I viewed the recording, and I think there was mention of a software version of the MSK modulator demodulator. In OpenCPI, we use a library called Liquid DSP, and that it contains a lot of DSP, a library of DSP components. So one of which, they have a CPFSK modem. And MSK is a special case of continuous phase frequency shift keying. So I implemented some of those, the modulator and the demodulator, to run on software. I have it working. So on the FPGA, I generate PRBS stream, and then I do the mod and demod in software. And then back on the FPGA side, I check the PRBS, and that's functioning 0-bit error rate. So the targeted rate for the MSK that we're looking for Opulent Voice is 27.1 kilohertz. The implementation I have in software runs at 4 samples per second, which differs slightly to, four samples per symbol. So it's running at 108.4 kilohertz. This is too slow for the 809363, and because this is generated in baseband and not in IF. So I added a CIC interpolator and a CIC decimator to bump it up to 2.168, which is the minimum, past the minimum required for the transceiver. So I've got it working with these additional components in the FPGA only. So it goes from the PRBS and the FPGA, goes to software to do the mod, and then it goes back to the FPGA to the interpolation decimation by 20, and then back to software for the demodulation, and then back to FPGA for the PRBS synchronization. This got a little tricky between going back and forth between the CPU and FPGA. The zinc on the Pluto is the 7010, and it was shy of the block ramps necessary to implement this. So I moved over to a different platform that OpenCPI supports, which is the Z board and the FMComps2 board for testing. So that was working with 0-bit error rate. So and then I moved on to attempt to do an RF loopback, but I haven't been able to get a bit error-free run of this. So I added instrumentation in between different stages of the interpolation and the mod and demods. This is a calculation of the max value of both the I and Q, and report back the signal. And then I also played around with getting the expected gains correct, but I'm still not getting it with RF loopback. So in addition to that, I added a complex mixer so that I can off-tune the baseband away from the center frequency, because sometimes the local oscillator leakage interferes to rule out the interference of the local oscillator, but that still wasn't working. The next thing I'm going to do is take a step back instead of going all the way to RF loopback, try to do an internal loopback. So going from the FPGA to the transceiver, but not leaving the transceiver, staying within the transceiver and coming back to the FPGA. And I'm also considering changing, instead of doing PRBS, taking a step back a little bit and just generating, either all fives or all A's to see how close I am on, modulating, demodulating, see the bit errors. So in Slack earlier, Michelle, you mentioned like a 7% bit error rate. And it's weird that I'm getting similar results with this RF loopback where it's around 6 or 7%. But that's a different implementation altogether. So anyhow, so I plan on continuing to debug this to see if I can get it to work, update my firmware, the latest firmware, to make sure that OpenCPI still works with what's the latest version of the Pluto MSK that's out there. And then see updating the FPGA components that I previously created with the latest, and then try to build, because I had an XSim simulation, try to get that working in simulation before attempting to do the FPGA side MSK mod and demod. So that's my update.
Wow, that's a lot. Thank you so much. Yeah, interesting. The error rate of between 6 and 7%. Yeah, we've been a little bit baffled about that. I don't have any sort of theory yet. I haven't dug in to try to figure out if there's if that's a big hint about what's going on. Yeah, no, and wow, yeah. I think we had very similar over the past week or so. We stopped using the RF loopback when the refined picture, the calculated PI gains, and we went through the theory and all and got much smaller numbers than what we were working with before. I did sort of expect like that if that was the if those were the right numbers, we would immediately see a huge improvement, and we didn't. So we dropped back to the digital loopback as well, just to remove any extra circuits, further down the chain. So we did the same thing over the past week or so. So I'm gonna ask Paul if he'll show the latest lab results. What we do is set up the radio, and then we step through PI gains. And what we did is we started out with where we thought we should be on the PI gains. And I think we kept the I constant, and then we started decrementing the proportional gain and just letting it run as long as we possibly could. We're using a fairly coarse resolution of 1/4096 in order to make this happen a little faster, and try to see if we just kind of brute force it at this point, since we felt like we were fairly close. Anyway, I'll turn it over to Paul. You should be able to share the screen to show the visualization from the, and it's still going on, this test. I'm just going to let it run while we're trying to figure out if we made an error in the formal sort of theory side. If we need to go back to that work and make sure. But we're just going to keep running the lab to keep testing gains. And so I'll turn it over to Paul to give us a tour of what we're looking at.
It's more of the same, basically. We have here the bit error count screaming up to the sky, and the bit errors hanging around the 7.8% ratio, repeatedly over and over again for many, many, many test cases. We started at mantissa value, by which I mean the number before it's shifted, of 100 hex, and counted down, and we rapidly got into the negatives and kept on going because we were busy doing Thanksgiving and other things. As you can see on the bottom graph, it starts out just barely above zero and then goes down. So most of these gains are probably nonsense, but it doesn't change the behavior much. That it does the same thing when it's a small net positive value as it does when it's a small negative value, and then increasingly large negative values, or numbers starting with FFFF anyway, not really negative. You can see from the empty third graph, or almost empty, that it's almost never in the right range of bit counts, which means that the bit error or the bit timing is never being recovered correctly. And from the fourth graph, you can see that it spends a lot of time with both accumulators railed. This is the same behavior we saw last time I showed you graphs. And from the fifth line, you can see the accumulator zoomed in far enough that it never hangs around zero, which is the expected behavior for the accumulators. So I don't think we've learned anything new from this long test run, except that it never magically fixes itself.
Yeah, it hasn't so far. And I'm inclined to just let it keep going and just let the radio stay busy. The neat thing is that we seem to no longer have the not a number problem. So the code doesn't blow up. We no longer see it come up with a zero bit count. Because what we do in order to get percent error is take the number of errors and then divide it by the number of bits. And we were getting at one point a fairly frequent not a number result. So there was a stall. There was something unhappy about our design, I think. But we have not had that. And we also have not seen the split spectrum anymore. And I'm going to go ahead and venture a guess because I don't know for sure yet that both of those problems may have been cleaned up when we stopped. When we changed from doing double, essentially double writes to some of these registers, initially it was when you set a register, you had to clear the register. Matthew changed it to a much more efficient way where if you toggle a bit in a register that you get the effect. And that seems to be the only change that has any correlation. Now that's not causation, so we should be careful saying that that's the thing, but the not a number problem and the split spectrum problem appear to be a whole lot more rare, if not gone, which is good. So,
Yeah, let me add a couple of caveats to that. That the split spectrum problem, we don't have a way to detect automatically. So when we say we're not seeing it, it's because we're not s literally seeing it on the screen, and we're not spending hours staring at the screen to make sure it doesn't happen. So it could be happening sometimes, but it does seem to be happening less than it was before. And as for the not a number, it may just be that because the bit timing is so wildly wrong that hitting zero would be a rare event because we're counting up so many errors and bits. It may be very difficult to surface the not a number problem. So those m may not be good news. We don't know.
That's true. We do have a catch though for the not a number, so it will report. It'll end.
Yeah.
It goes boom, but it reports out. The status. So we'll if it happens to us, then we'll know where. So I'm kind of inclined to just let this keep running and that we go back and review the theory and do a, I think Paul, you had said it's probably time to just go carefully through the HDL. One of the only other things that I have not followed up on this, I spoke up about it on Slack. We do have a delay because of the low pass filter. There's an IIR low pass filter in there and there's an extra delay. I don't It's a very low probability that that's the cause of any sort of weirdness. But some of this stuff does is delay dependent. And if it is in the path, maybe that's, I just couldn't find anything looking on any DSP forum about delays causing this bad of a problem, but you can really mess up some filters with a additional delay. Like the IR filter itself, you really just need one delay in there. So that was the only thing that I could think of in looking through the code, but it may just go back and say, okay, let's just look again. Let's step through and see to make sure that we have the multiple, essentially the gains for the control loops. They really are what we think they are, that we haven't inadvertently done anything that makes us look in the wrong direction. And I guess we could if we had a 1/2 to the 32nd as the resolution, the highest resolution that we could do, we could just brute force it at this point. But I don't even want to go look at how long that would take. You can see how long the 1/4096 or 1/2 to the 12th is taking, because we've gone from zero down to, yeah, it's like negative, well, -600. I mean, we'd have to let it keep running. And so to sort of see if we can catch the good results. And also another thing that we tried to do is we tried to recreate the good results we were getting before because we were getting some stability. we would get these brief bursts of two loop two and two and the result three, you know, which is you have a success, stable loop two stuff. When we say loop one, that means that it's still just trying to get out of the 50% error. And loop two is when it has essentially a 0% error. But we're still pretty much in loop one because the 7.8% error is not good enough to kick us into the loop two. So that's what we mean when we talk about the different loops in the test code.
Let me emphasize something you were touching on there. We tried to reproduce the results we were having before we changed the way the gains are expressed in the registers by
Right.
creating register values that would give the same gain, effective gain as we had before. And we didn't do a thorough test on that. We did not exhaust all the possibilities, but what we thought was the right register value did not produce the old behavior. And as far as we know, the only difference really is the is these gain registers. So something else has changed, and we don't know what. And that's why I think we need to go back to basics and maybe even try to look at the diffs in the HDL code and see if something has changed that we weren't aware of or that we hadn't thought of through the consequences of.
Okay. Yeah, you
Speaking of thinking of the basics, I was reminded recently that working with the 89363 reference design, that the clock, I think we're making an assumption that the clock that we're using is 6144 megasamples per second, but depending on how the transceiver's configured, it can be a multiple twice as fast or even qu a quadruple times the fat. Times as fast. So we're looking at 244. So maybe looking, does it make validating that the clock that we're using is the right frequency that we're expecting? I don't know, just a thought.
that's interesting. Do you have a thought about how to validate it?
There's some that I've used, some IP that basically does some calculation of it's basically a frequency counter inside the FPGA that what can report back and can use the clock and report back the frequency of the clock potentially.
What does it use for a reference then?
It'd probably be another clock. There should be another clock available from the PS, not use the AXE clock.
Yeah.
Yeah, the PS provides the PL some clocks. One of them, I think one should be 100 megahertz.
Yeah, that's what I remember. There's a 100 megahertz clock in the PS side.
We sort of do something equivalent to that by counting our buckets of bits based on elapsed time on the processor. So,
Yeah, there seems to be some bends in the when it's reporting the bit clock or a bit sorry bit count, and we see some clusters. I mean, I think Paul, you actually doodled out like how fast they were before. With the data that we have, I think we have a lot of results that we can go back and look at and see, what it's locking to. Would that, or what it thinks it's locking to, would that be indicative?
I don't know. You can definitely see the bends on this graph in the second row. You can see that the first horizontal line looking thing that's red is the error rate. So look at the second one. That's a fairly constant number that it's clustering around. That's way too high. That might give you a hint as to where the bit timing recovery is mistakenly landing, but I'm not sure what that would mean. At one point, it would look like it was a factor of 16,
Yeah, I remember
approximately,
that,
but
which
I
I
don't
mean,
know if that's still the
yeah, it was
case.
like a factor of two and a factor of 16. We were getting that sort of, I
What's
remember that.
the I gain here?
Zero.
Okay.
Zero C for that shift and all zeros for the mantissa. Let me check to make sure that didn't get mangled by my data graphing program.
So I meant to put in
That's
a
correct.
register where we can read back the actual frequency adjustment so that we see what the adjustment into the NCO is. I'm sorry I hadn't done that yet. So then you would know exactly how the NCO is being moved around.
Now that might reveal, that would reveal a lot. I think that would help us to kind of get some visibility into the loop. I'm pretty sure that, I mean, we're, yes, this will work. We will figure this out. It's you know, I think with a little more visibility and just being persistent and consistent that we'll figure out what exactly is misconfigured. You know, it feels like it's just misconfigured and that the basic design is trying really, really hard to do what we're telling it to do. Which is not what we would like it to do, but you know, that's what it boils down to. It's doing what we're telling it to do. So yeah, that would be something good over the next week, I think, to get into the essentially to spy on the loop. Like what are we telling the NCO to do?
Yeah, any little bit of visibility we could get would be helpful at this point.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'll just let this keep running so that we have a, because we have never actually done a full, as far as I can recall, we haven't actually done a full search through the entire space. This is just P space, I guess, you know, not really PI space, but setting the I to zero, you know, what it becomes a P controller, and that's okay. You know, we should see something perk up at some point.
Well, a P controller is working in simulation. I get
Right.
it locks and runs for, I think the 10-second run I did a few weeks ago was P equals one and I equals zero.
Right. Yeah, we should be seeing that, I think, with the, especially with digital loopback, you know, taking out the RF. So it feels like it's misconfigured that if the simulation is working, then there's something going on in the actual implementation in the larger, you know, reference design that there's something amiss here, and we'll just keep whacking away at it and we'll figure it out. But yeah, any visibility what into anything in the loop will really help, and then we'll just gather that information, and we'll also start reviewing and looking, you know, taking a look at the HDL to make sure that it gets another, you know, another good pass, another set of eyes on it. You know, but so far it looks right. You know, this is actually really it's difficult work, so we should be fair and say this is how it works. This is you know, tuning control loops is an enormous part of the job of a receiver, so not unexpected.
Matthew, what were the register values you used for that simulation?
They should be in the Slack. Well, maybe I didn't. I'm not sure.
They could be. I might have missed them.
Yeah, I have to scroll up. I mean, I think it was going to be a ways back in the Slack. I'd have to go find it.
Yeah, if we can duplicate the every all of the settings in simulation, that would be a really good thing to try to
Yeah,
confirm.
maybe I should just kick off another sim, and let it run for a few seconds. And with the latest code and with the P equals one and I equals zero, and just see what happens.
Yeah, that'd be useful, I think.
I mean, how many?
It
What's the duration of these runs that we're doing?
Several days.
yeah, this is
No, I meant the each individual run.
Oh.
Oh, about a second. So the each bucket of bits, when we talk about a bucket, we just let it run. We lift our hands and, clear,
Yeah. So if the RTL simulation is
that.
running multiple seconds, then we should be able to, I guess if we're not seeing the same result in, for a few seconds, with the same configuration, then yeah, then I don't feel like it's the RTL necessarily. I'm
Right.
not saying it's not. I'm just saying that's, in my experience, when something's not working in the lab that seems to be working in simulation, it's usually a configuration issue.
Right. Yeah, let's try to get the I think I have the code matching everything that you have in simulation, but let's go ahead and just be really sure. So if you just have a snapshot of every single register for setup, like here it is, I've set it up, here it is, here's what I'm doing. And then when you let it run for multiple seconds, then I can duplicate that completely and see what happens. And then we can compare that result. Because I've followed along, it's good to be independent. It's because that tests your documentation and your explanation as well and makes it better. So I've done the best I can with, like, this is how the radio is set up. This is what all these registers do. I think that they're in the right order. They're in the same order from the last snapshot that I got. But let's go ahead and, like, I need to match what you're doing. And the really at this point that we're looking for the lab to match the sim, and that's the goal. So at least over, like, I think that's something we can easily do over the next week is, you tell me, go ahead and simulate again for a couple of seconds to make sure that it's still stable and working, and then I will match your settings, all of your register settings, every last one of them, and then we let it loose in the lab and do a many seconds of buckets of bits and see what happens.
Yeah, I think that would be good.
I don't know if we even need to have multiple seconds.
Well, whatever, to just to match whatever is going on.
I just want to make,
That's pretty quick.
my
Like, you don't
concern
need them.
was, my concern was that if I'm not running the simulation long enough, then things, wander off and something's happening that comes later in the simulation, which is why I ran it for, tried to run it for about 10 seconds just to get it. So, I mean, if I'm running simulation longer than these bins that we're doing, right, these individual runs, then it would be reasonable to expect that we should get similar performance to the simulation. That the simulations that the RTL isn't wandering off into some weird state, much later than the simulatable.
Right. Yeah. No, that makes sense. But at a second long, I mean, that's quite a bit of time, and we're not seeing anything change dramatically within that second. When it was working, when we were getting it to lock, a second was more than enough time for it to behave, and it would repeatedly lock. So I was expecting to see that again when we tried to duplicate the same settings as before, using the enhanced and improved resolution. And so not seeing that was a little baffling. So that means that something's going on. So yeah, I think that's where we're at. So yeah, confirming it, making sure that it matches, and oh, see you soon, Aaron, and thanks so much. Looking forward to seeing you next week if you can make it.
Yep, thanks. Bye.
Thank you. So I have some updates when we have a chance.
Sure. No, you have the floor.
Okay. So I was a bit stymied this week or last. Let's see. I was a bit stymied this week or last because the ILA didn't go in, the integrated logic analyzer didn't go in the way I thought it did. I think I mentioned this before. So I was trying to rework how I put it in, and I have another approach that should work, but I'm getting back to that error that we were seeing before in my build. And
Oh,
that is the
where it can't find the file?
No, it's not. It's the error where it says it can't connect the two nets.
Oh, okay. Earlier.
And it's like really weird because I didn't change anything in the system BD file that does that, and it's not a net that's related to the MSK design. That's one of the other pieces. So I'm gonna try building the main line rather than the debug branch and see if there's any difference. If not, I'll just nuke everything and check it out again. But I was wondering if anybody, I mean, has anybody else done a build least recently that they had any issues with?
Well, I haven't tried to build it since we built it to kick off this long search through the space. But there wasn't any problem after we figured out the path. I think it was a little like a one level disagreement in the path in the TCL file, and that was the last problem that I saw for building.
I'm wondering if there's just some. It says there's an illegal character in the string,
An illegal
in the
character.
name.
Okay, that sounds
And
vaguely familiar because we were having a illegal character problem back a ways. That
and that was
that
something that
it was too long of a path name. It turned out that if your signal name is really, really long, that you it could it will that one of the Xilinx. I'm going to botch this, I'm sure, but I can go back and try to find it because I think we wrote a little bit about it. The illegal character came up because the signal name was long enough to where it exceeded a limit that Xilinx set. The name was truncated, therefore, and it ended with like an ampersand or some sort of weird thing in there or some sort of underscore, and then triggered this problem. And over on the Xilinx forums, which I do not visit as often as I do the ADI Engineer Zone forums, but on the Xilinx forums, I found people that were pretty ticked about this problem because it seemed like a silly restriction. So there we had a really long signal name, and when that was shortened, the problem with the illegal character went away. So it may
So
or
I
may
mean,
not be the problem here, but
I
that
can
was.
see I shared this my screen, and it's complaining about this, which is that this was just part of the system BD file that's worked forever.
Right. Yeah.
So you wouldn't expect it to be a too long of a name, and I
It's
haven't
got to be
changed
the
this file. So,
slash, right? It's got to
well,
be the
that's what I
slash.
thought, but there's other if you look above. There's other ones with the slash in it.
Yeah, this sounds familiar.
Yeah, I thought that at first, but that's the could it be the slash? But then when you look above, there's plenty with the slash in there. And again, this is something that's part of the stock Pluto. This
Right.
isn't something
Yeah,
that
this
we
is something that
changed.
we didn't put in a super long signal name. Yeah, Paul, do you remember anything about this?
No, I don't remember that issue that we had at all. Does the two hashtag symbols there at the beginning of the line not be, mean a comment?
It does. Vivado does this weird thing where it prints the tickle script with comments. So I don't know why it does this, but it does. So th this is just kind of a tickle, or I mean a Vivado thing that it does. And that, like, sometimes it prints it with one hash and sometimes two. And I think they mean something that I've never really dug in to figure out. But well,
Yeah,
you
you
can
see
see,
that
like, here
it
it's
prints
the
it as a comment to show, okay, this is the next one that I'm going to attempt. Then it attempts it, and then it.
yeah it, so you can kind of see that here, right? So you have the hash lady connect, and then it's running actually a different name, but connect BD net, and then so this is the actual command that's running. So I think it again displayed what it's going to do, but then the actual command is not shown because it errored. Well, I guess it's kind of shown down further.
It might be shown down further, but I think it's just trying to help you by showing you what it's going to attempt because the error message may or may not include that command. So
Yeah.
that you can tell which line it puked on.
Right. Yeah, I mean, so it does tell us right here, like this, I think that this is in the process that it's doing. Yeah, so line 351 is the where it
Right.
got unhappy. So
Yeah.
I gotta, so this is just a disappointing step back. So it's hindered me from getting the ILA included, but we'll get work through this. So it's just one status. I haven't done much else this week for, you know, it's been busy and holidays and whatnot. So the other thing then that I've been considering, and again, there's lots of reasons, you know, I think that the RTL simulations are seem to be okay, but we're not seeing the, you know, the corresponding behavior in the lab. So that's frustrating, and obviously, and so the ILA will hopefully help. If we have any more ideas of you know, readbacks that we could use, you know, like the NCO adjustment value, I think is useful. So we'll pull that out.
Yeah. Yeah,
But
I
if there's
think
anything else we can
that'll
think
definitely.
of.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we'll try to brainstorm and we'll try to keep it down to like a dull roar, you know, because
Yeah.
because
But then.
every bit of visibility comes at a cost and all that, you know. But yeah, just getting into the loop. I mean, it's like, you know, I'm looking at this and I'm like, it just is really like the slopes on these. It's like tilted all the way over and I'm like, where are you going? You know,
Yeah.
tell we're and we're telling it to do this, so it must be like that loop calculation. So it, maybe we can find out if we're giving the NCO reasonable results and it's giving us an unreasonable output, then we get to narrow it down a bit. So that would I think that one result, that one visibility bit of visibility would help at least narrow it down. And if we really are telling it to, you know, hard over. You know, to stern and floor it, then, you know, then we could go back a step and see, well, you know, based on your inputs, should you be telling it this, you know, and just look at the math, 'cause, you know, I think we know what we're telling it to do. And if we get it to match up with our theoretical, MATLAB stuff, then, you know, we'll just work our way backwards and find out where the divergence is, 'cause it's gotta be something in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, I thought of a couple other points. I mean, we probably should look at the output of the integrate and dumps in both arms in the Costas loop.
Oh,
And then
yeah.
well, which is just the error signal, right? On the
It is
Q
like
arm.
we're supposed to be doing it every bit time,
Well, no.
right? Oh
That's
no,
the
wait,
interesting thing about this.
every 'cause that's every other.
Well, no, it's in this demodulator, you have to do it. So you're receiving an F1 and F2, right? The demodulator is looking at a bit time, and you're transmitting F1 in a bit time or F2, right?
Yeah.
So you only want to update the error in the bit times that the loop was active. So if you're looking at the F1 loop, you're gonna integrate and dump, right? But you only want to update the PI output when you're actually receiving an F1 signal, right? If you're receiving an F2 signal, the error signal on the F1 is useless,
Yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So there's the part of the declock C clock thing is when you do that and you detect the bits and you say it's a one or a zero, but as part of that, you know if it was an F1 you received or an F2 you received, and there's a signal that basically enables the error update in the F1 loop or the F2 loop. So they're mutually exclusive. Only one will update during each bit time.
Right.
Then the Q arm, the I arm is the actual data that we're going to decode, but it's used to normalize the sign bit on the error because the phase can be shifting 180 degrees. So we send F1 as either 0 degrees or 180 degrees. And so the error signal will be positive or negative depending on whether we, the F1 was phase shift, if we're just talking F1.
Right.
So the bit, you take the MS, the sine bit out of the I arm, and basically multiply it, or invert the error from the Q arm if needed, right? And so that could be gotten backwards, right?
Yeah.
But given that it's working in the simulation, I'm fairly confident that it's correct.
And we saw that work before, where yeah, you get 50% error and then you invert and it works.
Right. Well, that's the PRBS inversion, right?
Yeah. That's not
So
quite
what
the
I'm talking about is the error signal out of the integrate and dump in the Costas loop.
Yeah.
We
Yeah.
don't we have to we don't know what its sign should have been. So the
Right.
I arm is, selects the sign, or normalizes the sign in the Q arm.
Okay.
So that's like a different thing that could be inverted, right? And then
Right.
the third thing that could be inverted is whether you add or subtract the PI gain from the NCO, right? So you could either, like, if you have a positive error, you could either make the NCO faster, or you could make the NCO slower, right? And
Right.
so that's another area that you could get backwards, or in an implementation. But again, given the RTL simulations are working, I'm pretty confident those are right.
Yeah, simulation is where you work out some of those particular questions which way is up. And
Yeah.
those shouldn't change based on resetting the hardware.
Yeah. The only thing that, would change potentially is the or should change in this design would be the phase ambiguity of the data output, right?
Yeah, and I think we've got a good, well, we have a decent way of like, okay, is it messed up? Try the other side. Try the other, flipping back and forth until it settles out. Like, and that seemed
And
to
as
work.
soon as we put in the a differential encoder, we won't have to do that anymore.
Right. Okay, yeah, I agree with you that it looks like it if the simulation is working, that this is giving you good results, that it I can't I don't know. Have we run out of things
Yeah.
to
Well,
chat?
yeah, so the only thing I was gonna comment here, and it's, I guess I came at this modem, I've been doing this for a lot of years. But I came at it from the exact opposite way of my normal process, right? Normally, we would implement a C modem, or a C model of the modem, or it could be MATLAB. I mean, you implement a model. We typically use C or C++ to get it to run as fast as possible, right? I don't know if MATLAB compiles to native code or not. But that was our motivation for using C models. And then but the C models were bit true. They modeled latencies. They model all these effects. And the thing about the latency, well, let me come back to that in a second. So they modeled latencies, and you could run these simulations for long times, and see effects of, like, latencies. If you had an extra clock of latency in your loop, what it did, how it affected performance. And so we've always, use these C simulations as our golden reference. Even going into ASICs, we would the C model was the golden model, and we bit matched the RTL to the C. And if the RTL bit matched to the C, then that block was signed off effectively. And then you of course do higher level simulations to make sure everything's playing well together, but the individual blocks were unit tested based on the C model vectors. And that served really, really well. Here, we didn't develop a C model. We did some work with MATLAB, but we didn't create a bit true model that we could generate vectors and run the RTL against. But my reasoning here is that this modem is so simple that it's feasible to run many seconds of RTL simulation and C performance.
Right. Yeah, it's
And
sort
so
of
we've
a
done that, and
simulation
but
should like fill the role of the model in C. It should. And
right. So we're instead of creating a C model, we created an RTL model, because the RTL model is simple enough that we can simulate it long enough to be, to determine its performance, to characterize the performance, right?
Yeah.
So I mean, so I just wondered for a moment, do we go back and do a bit, a C model or a MATLAB model that's a bit true? But I guess, as I'm talking about it, I'm not seeing that it's probably really beneficial
Yeah,
in this case, given the simplicity of this modem.
the Simulink model that I and as a Simulink learner, it's pretty clunky. The Simulink model that I have for this has yet to work. It looks pretty close, but it's ugly. And the data output, it looks like it might be in the ballpark. But it's not great. And I had a lot of trouble. The gains are of the, essentially the Costas loops are were just experimentally determined by inspection, by looking at the waveforms and saying, okay, looks like this is the least amount of overshoot where it's pulling in the changes in the demodulated data. It's adapting to it as fast as it can without overshooting. This is very crude way of setting your gains, but it didn't. And I stopped working on that when we made such great progress on the RTL. And it's like, okay, well, if you can simulate the RTL and it's working, then well, that's you that's taken the role of all of this work. Now, the Simulink work, like I learned how it operated, and we have some really good visualizations and a great transmitter model. But the receiver model, at least in Simulink, hasn't worked, and I did not. And I haven't really gone back to that to try to make it work. But it's pretty much the same. It's the same structure. It's more Hodgkart Massey. It's not the exactly what we're doing with the Massey. In other words, it uses the 2T rather than T timing and such. So it is a slightly different architecture. So I'd have to back up and redo it. And once you get
Well, I
it
think that's just an
at
issue in the modulator, right? I think the demodulator still works the same because it uses the two Costas loops, right? So I think
Yes,
so the two Costas loops are operating on a bit times, even if the so it's I think it's just in a di the difference is mainly the modulator implementation.
yeah, I think the clock recovery, like my clock recovery, I would have to do what you did. And like, okay, you get the 2T, but then you have to double it to get a T, to get a different frequency, and then that's what you're keying off of. There may be one other connection difference. But yeah, like you said, I mean, and once you get a Simulink or MATLAB model, you can convert it to HDL, but we have found out that it is not efficient. You really have to bust it down into the individual elements, and then it's lots of hand coding. So if you can already write Verilog or VHDL, it is not, it is it's not a huge win. So it's a
Yeah, it's a great teaching tool and it's a great maybe, prototyping tool, but if you need optimized code, it's
Right.
not the
Yeah.
tool.
I think I may have mentioned it on Slack, and shown some utilization results that just the bit that I did, which does not implement any of the fancy stuff or the multiplexing or any of the upper level Opulent Voice stuff, but it swamped the entire 7010. No, none of the HDL reference design from ADI could fit in. Like that's a huge. Does like you overutilization of the resources, which kind of stunned me. I was expecting it to be much smaller. So it's probably because I don't know how to configure it, but I'm just following along with the, plug and chug and create HDL and here you go, output it. Whereas when you're writing VHDL and you're using like Vivado, this is it's a completely different methodology for implementation, place and route and all that. So yeah, really
Yeah.
good learning experience and gives us a way to test things. So I wish I was b even better at MATLAB and Simulink so I could help out even more. So getting there. It's probably a better utilization of this particular tool to do things like we've been doing to try to express the loops. Just like, okay, we have these three control systems that we chain them all together, and then we can calculate what the gains should be. And using Gardner to do that, that's the kind of the go-to. person for these loops and locking and all. You know, I think we're it seems like it should work. So, you know, we're getting close, but still have to I think we're going to have to hit it with the tire iron again and you know, recheck the work and back up and make sure that everything is right. And yeah, with I think better visibility is going to let us, you know, better instrumentation is the only way that science advances. So if, you know, any sort of better instrumentation to the design and getting more results out, that's well worth it at this point. Since the, you know, the dice roll with like, okay, let's calculate the PI gains has not worked out quite yet. I'm not sure we can really be that far off.
No, this is what's really weird. It's that you know, if it's working in the RTL for the length of time that we've seen it, it should be readily repeatable in the hardware.
Yeah. Think we've got a good list of things to check, like the checking the clock and like what Aaron said, you know, just checking all the basics, making sure that it is doing what we expect it to do. I think we'll find out that the clocks really are where they should be at, but that's really worth checking. And then figuring out what we're telling the NCO to do, since that's the thing making the signal that's going zoom. And you know, I'll go back to the MATLAB that I did to work through to calculate the PI gains to make sure that there's nothing wrong. You know, I found a number of bugs along the way. You know, it's easy to mix up your cycles and your radians. You know, that's a big gotcha right there, but it all panned out. And all of the visualizations look pretty good. You know, we're getting a what we expect when we look at like the pole zeros and you know, that's all heartwarming and everything. But I'll go back and recheck that. I think we had some other action. Paul, is there something else I'm missing?
Took me a while to find my Zoom window. Yes, probably, but I don't know what it is.
Okay. Yeah, we'll knock off the cobwebs and get back to the lab and figure it out. Yeah, this is really super fun. This has been such a great design to learn and tell people about, and we've gotten a substantial amount of interest, and already I can tell that there's going to be a lot of opportunities to teach people about a really cool modulation. And so yeah, interest, you know, people are tapping their watch and going, "Well, are you done yet? Can we use your communications link?" You know, okay, just hang on. It's coming along. You know, so all that is really good feedback. So plenty of interest. University of Puerto Rico right now, they're all their students are in final exams and they're wrapping up the reports from the previous launch. They're going to be starting on the next sounding rocket project and application for Wallops and NASA. They're very interested in using this particular version, the MSK version of Opulent Voice for their launch. DSES is very interested in using it because they think it will fit in with some of their projects and experiments. So yeah, it isn't just an academic exercise. I think that it's pretty clear that there's a strong interest and appreciation for it. And you know, I keep looking to try to find if there's some other open source implementation of a real solid MSK link out there. There really isn't a lot at all. Just there isn't. So this is gonna
You
that's
mean in a hardware?
yeah, just
Yeah.
isn't, you know. And you know, when you speak about, you know, maybe looking at a bit accurate model and software, I haven't spent as much time trying to track down MSK implementations and software, but it might be good. Maybe we can go leverage one if one is out there that can do the things that we're wanting to do.
Yeah. I mean, like, you know, I think we're going to want to experiment, you know, once we get this working, with different receiver architectures, including like non-coherent architectures, such that you don't have to wait for these loops to lock. You know, you just, but you, they typically don't perform as well. Your SNR, your your threshold is typically higher with a non-coherent receiver, but it might be something useful, in our application to have a non-coherent receiver as well.
Yeah, that's for sure. That'll be fun to compare.
But that's what's neat about, I think, this architecture and this modem is, you can plug and play. And you could have different receiver architectures, easily. We can experiment with different ones and, see how they track, how fast they lock, how well they track, especially like with Doppler shift, how they work in those types of environments. I think it'll be really interesting.
That's true. I think we have a little bit of a preview with that with RF Bitbanger Project's SCAMP protocol now in FLDigi, in the main FLDigi, not in the, so it's now moved the kind of the official program from what I understand, rather than being in a essentially a alpha or test build. And I've been keeping my ears open for anybody that's doing any sort of side by side with, like, how does it compare, from your computer using FLDigi versus the kit, the RF Bitbanger kit. So I'm really looking forward to being able to do those sorts of comparisons and try different architectures and figure out where all the many different inflection points in the design is. So yeah, we're not that far. The sort of work what we're doing right now can be feel a little bit like lost in the woods, but just looking at the graphs, I think it's doing what we're telling it to do. So we need to speak its language or teach it a new one.
Yeah. You know what I just realized?
that?
I had pulled the AXI, the ADI updates for their build structure, right? So my HDL, I hadn't changed it, but I pulled a whole bunch of new commits. Maybe
Oh.
that's why I'm having that problem. Now the question would be, what did I have before? I think it should be in the Pluto log. I'll look.
Still, yeah, it should be in git log. I've done that.
Yeah.
Yeah, they update that pretty aggressively, and some of the updates are breaking occasionally. You can look
Yep, I
at
think that must be what happened. I bet that's what happened.
Cool. Okay. Well, we'll stand by and wait to hear back.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we got our work cut out for us, and it's a blast. And let's see, is there anything else that you can think of that we should look at or do or go
Yeah,
chase?
my sense is the three things that are in my mind right now, just for moving this debugging forward, would be getting the ILA in. The second thing would be running the simulation for a longer duration and double checking the hardware configuration in the lab against that. And then the third thing would be adding some more readback visibility points. So I think, those are the kind of the three next steps in my mind.
Okay. Yeah. Hardware configuration, making sure that we're matching what you're doing in sim, like exactly, like just sell out, just duplicate, and then the ILA and more readbacks.
So, Paul, to the simulation question, do we have any status on a VM that can run an MVC?
No, I haven't done anything about that. If we need to, if it's okay to do it on a different VM, then it should be easy to install MVC on a VM that more recent version of Ubuntu.
Yeah, that'd be fine.
Okay, I will do that.
Thanks. Because then that way, I'm not running on my laptop, which I turn off or, close the lid on or whatever. We can run it longer, a little bit easier if we can do that.
Yeah. Since you showed me that screenshot of your error message, I've been pondering it and searching, and I Googled up a bunch of web pages that I have Googled up before. which is consistent with Michelle's memory that I don't have, that we have looked at a similar problem before. And what it was then seems to have been that the Xilinx code will silently truncate your names to a particular length. It'll then append its own identifier, which in this case was an underscore zero. And if the truncation ended on an underscore, then you have a variable name with two underscores in it, which is magic in Tickle
That's
and
right. That's
causes things to go wrong.
what happened to us. That
So
triggers that memory. That happened to us before.
that's what you need
Okay,
to
so
look
what
for,
was
something where you exceeded a variable name length limit that's undocumented, and it happened to fall on an underscore.
Yeah, 'cause
Okay.
they append an underscore and then like a zero or one or two, depending on whether the previous signal name was the same. So if you have, if it truncates it and it has to then do this five times, then you get underscore zero through four. But then if it just happens to be, if you end up with a double underscore, then it chokes. And that happened to us. This is something that it took us days to track down. So who knows? It might be that, because that's the same error message that we got.
Well, I was able to check out the previous HDL commit, so
Good.
hopefully I can run this and it will work.
Yeah, it might make
They
it
may
go
just
away.
know they broke something
Right?
along the way.
Exactly. Yes. Never a dull moment. Cool. Okay, well, we'll get to work. Yeah, any last comments before we close?
Don't think so.
All right. Well, excellent. And we'll do this again in a week, and see you on Slack.
Alrighty.
All right.
All
See you soon.
right. Thank you.
You bet.